Chuchum. Hey everyone, I think that we started already. My name is Mariano Martino. I'm the managing director for Microsoft for Startups in Latin America, and today I will be talking about tactics for navigating a time of crisis, which, as every single one of us know, it's like today. So let me run down how I will handle this conversation. The main idea is to give you tools, or at least give you a framework where you can rely to make better decisions. At the end of the day, every single one of us on the startup ecosystem or the investor ecosystem, we are trying to make decisions on the fly and in an environment that we really don't know, or at least that, as I put in this slide, has many unknowns, okay? And that gets into domino effect. So I would rather start talking about briefly about the market, then I will talk about ourselves as entrepreneurs, and then I will talk about the team, the decisions that we have to make, and the product market fit as a way to measure how we can create a sustainable business, okay? So let's get started, and the first thing that I will say as a general concept is that we need to adapt and overcome. Okay, right now the market has a lot of unknown unknowns and domino effects, and all these unknown unknowns are kind of reflected in this slide. For instance, in 2019 we were thinking in ecosystem and startups where the growth was our mantra. Growth at all costs was everything around. And in 2020, now everyone talks about of profitability at all costs, mainly because the runway, it's the new product market fit. Because runway, we don't know when the COVID crisis will finish, we don't know how the markets will change, and we don't know how much of that change will be incremental, or will be temporary, or will be forever. So the runway is what make us really think on profitability as our key metric or our key objective. The second thing that after runway we have to think is the unit economics of our products. So when we were talking about revenue before, and this is a really key difference, especially for entrepreneurs when they talk with investors or when they talk with other parts of the ecosystems, is to understand that the unit economic or the net addition that you bring to your company in every single transaction that you make, it's the new revenue. When we were talking about revenue, we were talking about the growth at all costs. Now we are talking about profitability and how we get to that profitability as soon as possible, or at least as soon as possible while we have runway. And the main thing is, okay, how do we get cash flow positive in our companies? How we have the cash flow in a positive state in a way that we can negotiate better terms or better deals when we are selling our products or when we are talking with investors, okay? And talking about investors, one of the things, and this is one of the things that it's an unknown, okay? We are talking about how raising capital has changed. If we were thinking maybe 3 months before, or maybe at the beginning of the COVID crisis, everyone would tell you that the markets were draining, that the outlook for raising capital was changing, and suddenly this is not entirely true. We really don't know if this is, or at least we are analyzing if this is because current VCs have a lot of dry powder in their pockets, or if it's because they are realizing that a lot of digital transformation is happening. But raising capital has changed, and it has changed in a ways that we still don't know how permanent will be. the even the interactions with VCs are being remote? And how do you interact with VC in a remote form? How do you interact with VCs that are not even in your market? This is a reality that we have to face. So raising capital has changed. No one knows, or at least no one knows for sure, how it will change long term. And at that point is when I think that communication is key. Okay, communication is key with all the stakeholders that we have, and this is the main thing that we have to have in mind, especially to survive in these turbulent times, because communications bring a clarity. Communications help get your team together. Communication lets your team understand why are you making decisions. Communications let your investors understand what's the rationale behind your decisions. And basically, communications is the way to get to know every single one of your stakeholders, and explaining them in the most ruthless way possible what's happening in your company. And a couple of things that are really key is when we talk about all these changes, what we have to understand is this, is you are building a company in a time when the world is not normal. And this not normal can be divided in two different sets of not normal or new normal. The first one is there are acute new problems that need to be solved now, okay? And this is why I put a moment. The moment that we are living, it's a moment that we have these acute new problems. And the problem of the moment, like remote work, school and life, healthcare, this means that there are new cases for our technology or your product, and you need to be paying attention to what they are. New problems that people are facing today, and you need to be asking yourself if you have a solution for that, okay? And when I talk about a solution for that, I talk about even if that solution is not perfect, you have to ask yourself constantly if you can bring something to the market. And in times of crisis, the rewards goes for companies that are highly agile. And this is due to the transformational nature of the moment in time, okay? Who would have thought 6 months ago how much effort would be placed today in IoT or robotics startups? Figure out things like touchless, trash pickup or touchless payment or touchless anything. Or how can we enhance automated health screening in spaces of high transit? How can we work in offices, in transportation centers, even in malls, wherever they are open? In some countries are open, in some other countries are closed. But you have to think about that. And for instance, I use Precog that as one example. This is a company that was working with us in the United Kingdom, and they were dealing with crowd security. Basically, they were understanding how the crowd was behaving to understand if specifically there was a problem in crowd management, and then realized that they have a solution that can help with the tracing and contact tracing to avoid spread disease in crowds, something that they never thought before, but they were agile and they were fast to discover things. But then if this is the momentary solutions and these are the new market opportunities that are arising, the other thing that you have to understand is that there is going to be a new normal. No one knows specifically what the new normal is, but or we don't know yet what it will look like or how different it will be from what normal used to be for us. Let's talk about remote work. I mean, I'm working from home. We were discussing with the team what that means for us, but this is not the new normal long term, hopefully, okay? But you have to understand that in times of crisis, as you are rewarded on the agility, the other thing is that generally lead to things that are completely different. And the companies that have the foresight and the luck to understand it have a real advantage. For instance, Taobao in China, the world's, and I'm talking about the world's largest e-commerce website, was founded when people were stuck at home due to SARS in 2013, which is exactly, or at least really similar to the moment that we are living right now. So you have to look at the macro trends that are impacting society beyond e-commerce. You have to start looking closer at these trends and how this will create opportunities where your technology might already be applicable. And if you follow me, you are seeing that I'm talking about a lot about the things and the decisions and the analysis and everything. And to be really, really honest here, first things, you need to take care of yourself. And this is not personal. This is not taking care of yourself because you are being egoistic, okay? You have to take care of yourself because you are expected to execute at the highest level and make the tough calls ASAP. Any delay will limit your capacity to react. Any delay will limit your capacity to bring products to the market. And even any time that you don't have the ability to really analyze and define context, you will not be able to make good decisions. Okay, so in times of crisis, if they are rewarding companies that are highly agile, that means that they are rewarding people that is agile and people that is able to make decisions. And to make decisions, you have to, I mean, this is really no magic, okay? You have to exercise daily, you have to drink a lot of water. And honestly, I keep talking about the emotional impact of being an entrepreneur and how you handle that level of stress that every single entrepreneur or startup is having, okay? So sharing with your partner, and I'm including this even when some people say that this doesn't make any sense, I keep including this. You have to share with your partners what are you going through. And when I'm talking about your partners, I'm talking about your personal life partner, be it your husband, wife, someone, whoever is in your life. They need to understand what are you going through, because that way they will be able to support you. Okay. Finally, good luck. You always need to have some luck. And once you have to understand this, and remember that I said, okay, I will talk about the market, and then I will talk about how to take care of you. What I really need to hopefully make clear is that clarity and focus are key to overcome conflicts. And I'm really, really an advocate for clarity. Clarity brings teams together. Clarity brings everyone together to go to a specific point with your company. So honestly, acting decisively and making a lot of tough decisions, it's kind of easy, but you have to communicate with clarity why you are making these decisions, okay? If we are talking about runway and we are talking about finances, you have to reduce your spend without breaking your product. You have to increase revenue without breaking your product. But at the same time, you will have to, if we are talking about net revenue, you have to kill products with negative contribution, and that will impact your team. So at the end of the day, you have to improve operating capital and preserve it to grow the revenues and the product that are bringing those revenues to the company. Okay, and everything is on the table. Honestly, I keep saying this, everything is on the table. You are open to renegotiate everything. Every single contract that is on the table, be it your providers, your technology providers, your connectivity providers, any single provider, and every single contract that you have open, it's completely open to negotiation. Okay, so please be completely aware that everything is on the table. And finally, you have to be ROI obsessed. I mean, you have to keep pushing your product to the market. And this is something that is real, because otherwise you will not have income or revenue. But you can't do no capital marketing. The idea of having marketing and having communications without even expenditures, it's completely ridiculous. Okay, so instead of trying to figure out how to make marketing without any capital investment, think on doing marketing, investing only in channels that are really, really measurable. And once you have all of this, okay, once you have all these measurable channels on the table, everything, now that you have all your contracts renegotiated and you understand what products are giving net contributions or negative contributions, you have to adapt daily. And again, I go back to the first or the second slide, where I keep saying that opportunities arise every single day, but you have to be clear in your mind and in your focus to go forward. Okay, so it's really clear that you need to adapt daily and communicate with clarity. And this will take me to something that it's not. This is not something that it's really easy to talk, okay? But teams will change. I mean, your teams will be impacted one way or another. So instead of delaying making these decisions, one thing that you have to do is to understand this and own this, okay? You have to own this moment. You have to own this specific moment, which is making the hard decisions that you have to make in a lot of moments regarding your team. And this goes back to the first point of your startup. You are leading a team, you are leading a company. So you have to take responsibility between your stakeholders or shareholders. And I can use it in the same sense. Stakeholders, because you are reporting to someone, or shareholders, because you are a CEO and you have people that have invested in your company. But you sit between your shareholders and your employees, okay? And this is something that I took from the founder of Carta when they had to fire all people. You sit between shareholders and employees. So you have to take responsibility and understand that you are the one that has to make the decisions, thinking in both point of views, okay? Because you are responsible for both of them. You are responsible for your shareholders' revenue and returns, and you are responsible for your employees' well-being and career growth, okay? So the first thing that I would do is assess all your teams, okay? You have to understand what your teams are doing. You have to implement first a hiring freeze to understand where are you seated and why. If you are implementing this hiring freeze, you have to understand why were you thinking about hiring people? What were your needs? The second point is find the low performance, the low performers across the org. This will let you know if which resources or which people it's not performing at their best, and if you can help them, or if you have to have them as a potential let go people, okay? And finally, you have to define the teams to be impacted and the positions at risk. You have to understand that it's really difficult to say that your teams will change without being specific. Not every single one in the company will be impacted the same way. It will not be your core engineering team will not be impacted as your, let's say, your ecosystem development team. So you have to define the teams to be impacted and the positions at risk. And once you have that, if you already understood which are the low performers, which are the contribution to the company, and how the teams will be impacted, you have to communicate. And when you communicate, again, you have to communicate with clarity. You have to be really specific on taking ownership and explaining that this was your decision and why this decision was made. Okay, there was a lot of really, really bad scenarios going on lately. One of the worst was a company laying off 400 employees via a Zoom pre-recorded message, what was the worst thing. And then there was the Carta team, which was even thinking on the long-term benefits and what benefits they can still provide for the people that were laying off. Okay, so you have to be really clear on every single decision that you are making. The second point is reduce expenses. Okay, if you are going to assess your teams and you will have to start firing people, the first thing that you would do is start, instead of doing that, start reducing expenses, reduce salaries, and start by the top and go down to the pyramid. Okay, you cannot expect to people on your pyramid in the pyramid of your team to understand that they are getting a cut when the top people in the company is not getting a cut in their salaries. Okay, eliminate all discretionary expenses and travel. And I'm really draconian in this kind of things. For me, being a former entrepreneur and having founded at least three companies, when you have to make the decisions to let people go, if you were not first reducing expenses, you are not being responsible. You are not being responsible to the team, and the team is people that have trusted you. So eliminate all discretionary expenses and travel, and cancel bonuses if you have them, because every bonus and every dollar that you save can be used to support your team. And finally, assume everything that you communicate, everything that you say, everything that you do will be public. There's no NDA, there's no anything that can prevent stupid things to go public. Otherwise, we would not ever listen about a company laying off 400 people through a pre-recorded Zoom meeting. Okay, so assume everything will be public, and assume that everything that will be public will be able to hurt your company, not you, your company. Okay, honestly, one of the best examples is the people at Carta. The people at Carta were completely open on the process that they follow to work with their team, and you should look on the internet on Carta, actually in the Carta blog, how they were making these decisions, because they were point by point explaining what kind of bonuses were they canceling, what kind of decisions were making, how they decided which part of the companies were impacted and which not. So again, let's go back and say, okay, we already saw the market conditions, then we started thinking on the founder or in the leadership team, then we understood what can we do on the financial level and the team. Now we have to talk about the product, and to talk about the product, the best way at least to talk about the product is talk about the product in a way where we can have a really easy to understand quadrant. Okay, we have to start thinking on how to create a sustainable product. Okay, and any single entrepreneur needed to understand that in this point of the market where there's so many unknown and unknowns, we should be aiming to get a sustainable product, because the product market fit and the retention is what will give you a long-term runway and a long-term revenue. So once you understand this, I will say focus on the quick ratio and the retention. And you can divide this in three points: how you get the customer acquisition, how you get the customer activations, and how you get to customer retention. The first thing that I would do is remember that I said that do marketing only do the marketing that you can measure. Do only the marketing that you can measure, that you can specifically address, and you can specifically compare to a period in time that can give you a hint where are you going. Okay, so basically gaining new customers is is how you get new customers to the company. And the key metric here, it's not difficult. It's the CAC, which is the customer acquisition cost, which is the related expenses and the cost divided by the customers. And the main difference here, specifically in B2B, because at least the kind of startups that we are working on and the kind of startups that I've invested for the last times for the last years are is B2B is that the sales cycle and the multiple stakeholders that you have to take. Okay, so every time that you have to talk about customer acquisition, understand that if you are B2B, once you have a customer, the main issue is how to acquire a customer, but also that acquiring a B2B customer is completely different than acquiring a B2C customer. But the churn is way lower in B2B than in B2C. So you have to work that. Okay. And these are the main channels. I will not go in really deep into these channels, but at the end of the day, these are almost all the channels that you have. One thing that I would say, as I said before, that assume that everything goes public, please devote some time to have good PR and communications, because this is what will give you the narrative that you can adapt to different markets. And this narrative will be, in these specific times of crisis, needs to be completely cohesive. This narrative has to be the same internally and externally. And this narrative is what will drive you. If you have a clear narrative and you are driving clarity to your team, this narrative will be easily adaptable to internal stakeholders, which are your employees, and the external stakeholders, which are your investors, but also your customers. And then you can go into content marketing, social media marketing, mobile optimization, etc. But please be really aware about the PR and the narrative that you need to adapt. Dedicate a lot of time on polishing this narrative. Okay, once, but let's say you already have your customer and you want to have your customer. If you don't activate your customer, and activate the customer, it's something that it's usually not really double. People don't do a double click on it because they don't like to get into the details. Honestly, the way that you have to activate your customer is getting your customer to start using your product. Okay, it's not really good for you to have a customer that has downloaded or started, I don't know, that installed your app or downloaded your product or something, or is testing your product if they are not using it. Okay, so this goes as I say here, it's goes from staying a bit longer on your site to signing up for a new account. And this is something that you have to define. This definition of what's a daily active user, it's from the Microsoft Teams team. Yeah, the Microsoft Teams team. So basically, at Microsoft, we define a daily active user of Teams as the maximum daily users performing an intentional action in the last 28-day period across the desktop client, the mobile client, and the web client. I'm using this definition first because this is a public definition that we have, but also because it's really concise. It explains to you that we really don't care if we have 300 to 500 million Teams applications downloaded. We want to understand how many people is using that. So when we go into our public results, we talk about why we have more than 75 million daily active users. And when you get into this detail, you will realize that, yeah, those are customers that already have activated their product and that are using their product. So this is the way that you have to understand activation. It's a really good definition on when a customer makes an intentional action. It doesn't, and it really goes well to everything that goes to subscription and to SaaS, software as a service company. Okay, and the strategy is really simple: AB, every landing page and every product feature to understand how you can drive this activation, how you can drive specific actions, how you can drive intentional actions. Okay, and once you have your customer activated and your customer has become a user, okay, that's the main distinction. You have to start thinking on the retention. Again, the retention is the metric on how many people like your product enough to return over and over and over again. Okay, this is really simple, and this is the key of how you can define it is more actions and less churn. Okay, that's engagement. The metrics are really simple. The metrics are daily active users or monthly active users, and you use time frames. This is really interesting. You have to use time frames to understand the user cycle in your products. Okay, so you understand when a user is really engaged or when your user is at risk of leaving your platform. And the benchmark, this is the only way to understand your chances. If you don't benchmark constantly against your competition, you are in trouble. The main strategies, and this is key specifically for this time, is how do you get to identify your super users? How do you get to identify the people that it's key for making peer-to-peer recommendations, that it's driving your mouth, word-of-mouth marketing. Okay, so this is really interesting. And removing friction for new users is the other key strategy. Okay, once you have your super users and use them to understand how can I build a better product, you will understand how to remove the friction for you the new users. And the friction can be either as a long sign up process, which honestly it's a turn off for everyone. And the other thing can be, okay, how can I understand the value of having different channels to work within an application? The friction, the moment when a user, a customer understands your product and starts proactively using it constantly, it's key for you. So ultimately, retention is driven by increased engagement and removing this friction, like exposing your users to your product magical moment as early and as frequently as possible will reinforce your product value proposition and will drive them to return to the product. Okay, this is key, the return to the product, and as well as to engage more deeply and more frequently. This will first increase short-term retention, and later in time, hopefully, if you have runway, etc., will manifest in better long-term retention, your product on the road of the sustainable growth that we have on top right of our framework. Okay, and that's how you can think of retention as product market fit. Okay, and how do we start thinking on this? Well, the first thing is that I would say, use quick ratio, okay? Use quick ratio to understand not only how are you driving your business, but also to a really shorthand way to combine growth, retention, and churn into one single number that describes how efficiently your product is growing, okay? You can think about it as a way to measure the heartbeat of your product, as it shows you how many users are joining, staying, and leaving in any given period. Okay, most founders already measure churn for their product. However, churn is a really relative metric. Okay, bringing new customer acquisitions and resurrections of previously active users or active customers into the picture and calculating the quick ratio is a really good way to put churn into perspective and understand the overall health of your product. If we go into the and give me 1 second, laser pointer. Okay, if we go here, you will understand, and this is key. You can if you look only at your active users, you will be seeing only one part of your health. If you are looking at the churn, you will look only at other part of the picture. But if you start removing the customers that were retained, you will see how the growth is happening in your product. These customers either through acquisition and the resurrected customers, okay, customers that were using your product and suddenly left, but now are back, are really good to understand why. What's the interesting thing of your growth? It's your growth really this 20% monthly over month, or is it the growth bigger but you are having a lot of churn? This is why I keep saying that. Sorry, I'm having to take out the laser, but this is why the quick ratio will show you the net growth of your company. Okay, and this is really, really important for you. The second point, and this is the key of success for a moment like the one that we are living, and this is really important, is, okay, how can I look at this quick ratio, or how do I look at this net growth? Give me 1 second, sorry. How do you look at this quick ratio to make decisions? How can I, in a moment of crisis, how can I work to make better decisions and to understand in which moment am I and it's my company while this pandemic is still on the market? Okay, and again, if we look at this, we will see, if we look at these segments, we will see different things, okay? We will see different growth trajectories, but at the end of the day, when you start looking at the user quick ratio, what we will see is that they are completely different, okay? So having different time frames will be key for you to understand what are you doing great and what it's not doing great. For instance, if you have a rolling quick ratio, you can understand when did you introduce new features, when you removed some features. If you removed one feature, what was the impact? And you can measure it immediately. So this is really good to have a quick ratio on a rolling basis on a KPI dashboard. So you don't have to wait until the end of the month. You can look at this and you can iterate as quickly as possible. This way you can track and take actions on the fly. You don't have to wait. And this is, again, I will go back to the first or the second slide. Times of crisis rewards agility. And this is something that you have to understand. So using different window sizes to see long-term trends and look past seasonality effects will help you, because the product in inherent seasonality is manifested in the peaks and the valleys of the larger window size, okay? And also it will help you compare growth efficiency in the important segments of your business, not only geographical locations, but segmented quick ratio analysis can apply to any segmentation method, whether it's marketing. Are you using new marketing channels? Are you using a new narrative that we were talking about before? Are you using a new segmentation method, a new platform? Did you introduce, for instance, let's say you have an app and you introduce a Android version of your app instead of an iOS platform? Did you gain a lot of new users? Okay, how these users are driving more revenue or not? Are they driving more revenue or not? With this kind of decisions, you will be able to understand anything that that can be done in your business as soon as possible. And once you understand this, the rolling quick ratio can help visualize which customer segments are contributing really and positively to the overall quick ratio of the company and which are dragging it down, so you can again allocate the resources as fast as possible, especially in times like this. So again, let me go back a bit and make a recap. The first thing is that we have a lot of unknowns, okay? We have a moment where a lot of uncertainty and domino effects are happening. And you can look at that in a lot of companies that are getting a lot of round venture rounds, but companies that are being acquired, because otherwise they would not be able to succeed. If you understand that, you will understand that the agility that you mind need, because it's your mind the one that needs this agility, needs to be really well taken care of. And that's why I ask you to take care of yourself, to understand better the moment and the decisions that you have to make. Second point is understand the value of having clarity, decisions, and understand the different moments that we have regarding profitability or growth. Finally, we have to understand that every single team will be completely touched by this pandemic, or at least this time of crisis. And this is something that we have to understand. And once you understand that, and you understand that everything will be touched, and everything can and will change for good or for worse. This is not necessarily always for worst, but it can be for good. You will understand where you have to grow, but to understand where your team needs to grow or where your product needs to grow, you have to make informed decisions. And making informed decisions goes to these final slides, which were the rolling quick rate, the quick ratio, the growing, the rolling quick ratio, and the value of the retention rates in every single startup. So again, this was mainly the idea of driving this conversation, and I thank all of you for coming. The Reactor team will be sharing with you some of the upcoming events and more about the things that we have on the Reactor for you. So again, thanks for coming. I stopped sharing my screen right now, I think. And I'm open for questions if there's any.
Thank you so much, thank you everyone for joining today. We have a few links in the live Q&A section. If you are interested in rewatching this event today, or if you would like to share it with some other people on your team, we have a link to the Reactor YouTube channel. This video, or the recording of this event along with the slides, will be posted there in the next 24 to 48 hours. We try to get it up as quickly as possible. And then we've also posted a link to our Reactor survey. If you do have a few minutes and you can go in and fill it out, it shouldn't take you very long at all. It will ask you, the first question will ask you for the event code that helps us make sure that the answers we're getting go back to the correct event that it was from. The event code for this one is 7645, and that is also in the live Q&A chat as well. So I'll post that survey link again along with the event code. Again, thank you so much for joining. It doesn't look like we have any questions at this time, but we can give folks a few more minutes. I know we're on a slight delay, so we might see a few questions come in. And so yeah, we'll give everyone a couple of minutes and I will repost those links again. Please check out our Reactor meetup pages. We'll send a couple links out to those, and you can check out all the events we have coming up, as well as sign up for our Reactor newsletter.
This moment is kind of weird for everyone watching, okay? Because this moment for someone who is used to be in live events, it's kind of really weird to not seeing every single one participating, but just that.
All right, well, it doesn't look like there's any questions, so we must have covered everything really well. Mariano, do you have any closing remarks or anything you'd like to say?
No, honestly, I want to thank you for the invitation. I want to thank everyone that have participated here. And again, this is a really tough time, but we can make we need to make the best of it. So that's my final message.
Thank you so much, and thank you everyone for joining us today. And we hope you can join us for an event again soon. Have a great rest of your day.